and for sin condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God. It is not subject to the law of God. Cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, verse 9 is a pivotal verse, because it indicates that the ones that Paul were referring to earlier about being carnally minded and they that are after the flesh, and so verse 9 tells us that he wasn't talking about Christians, because he says if you have the Holy Spirit, you are not in the flesh but in the Spirit. But we'll look at that a little later. Verse 10, and if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken or make alive your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. As I begin, brethren, I think I'd like to say that when God illuminates our spiritual eyes and our understanding and makes his word clear to us, we have to exercise care that we do not use that illumination, or if you prefer, revelation of truth, as a parking lot. A lot of groups, the Lord reveals a certain truth to them, and what they do is to make the truth that is revealed to them a parking lot, and they never move from that. That is their whole understanding of truth. They never believe that there's any further truth that they can learn. They never believe that there's anything else, and so that's where they camp out. But if we want to be persons who continually hear from God, our attitude must be different. We must always say, like Paul, if any man thinketh that he knoweth anything, he knoweth nothing as he ought to know. We must always remember that the best of us, Paul himself said, we know in part. So it is a arrogant person who believes that he or she has all truth. Nobody has all truth. No group has all truth. We must always be seekers after truth. And the word of God is timeless. Remember now that the word of God proceeds from a God of whom it is said, from eternity to eternity, thou art God. His word is not time bound. It's relevant for every age. We must be careful that we have a relevant word for every age, because every age is different. So we have stated in our first two lessons that Romans 8 may be referred to as the Christian's Declaration of Freedom. Paul speaks of four spiritual freedoms that we enjoy as Christians because we are identified with Jesus Christ, and we are looking now in this lesson, we will begin to look at the second of these spiritual freedoms: freedom from defeat, no obligation. Freedom from defeat, no obligation. Paul is going to make the point as we go along that there is no reason for us to live in a manner that is not pleasing to God. We don't have any obligation to the flesh anymore. We are free, so we don't have to live a life that is dominated by the flesh. We should not. In verses 3 to 4, which we considered the last time we met, Paul wrote, "For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us." Notice that. The righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. The righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us. It's not that we are going to fulfill the righteousness of the law. The righteousness of the law is going to be fulfilled in us. That's very important. Very important. And when we read the Bible, we must make note, brethren, I know that I've said this before, but please, I want to beg of you, those of you who are seekers after truth, do not come to the Word of God with your preconceived ideas. That's always, it can be dangerous, but it's always limiting, because you'll never move beyond a certain paradigm. Because if you come to it with your preconceived idea, it's going to be difficult for God to teach you anything new. And you're always going to try to fit your old paradigm into what God is trying to tell you. Jesus said this on one occasion. He said, "No," he understood it. And he said, "No man who has tasted old wine immediately desires that which is new. For he says the old is better." Many of us are like that. But there is hope, because he says, "No man who has tasted old wine immediately desires new wine." They don't desire it immediately, but there is hope that one day they will. In verse 5, Paul now gives a further description of the two classes of people to whom he had made reference in verse 4. He had made reference to those who walk according to the flesh, or who walk after the flesh, and he made mention of another class who walk according to the Spirit, or who walk after the Spirit. So in verse 5 he says, "They that are after the flesh," he's beginning now to describe the two groups a little bit. He says, "They that walk after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. Think about it. They that are after the flesh, he says in verse 5, do mind the things of the flesh. But they that are after the Spirit, they mind the things of the Spirit. Bear in mind that word mind. They do mind the things of the flesh. Now the New Living Translation puts the verse like this. Those who are dominated by the sinful nature, those who walk after the flesh, those who are dominated by the sinful nature, think about sinful things. But those who are controlled by the Holy Spirit, think about things that please the Spirit. Those who live according to the flesh, listen carefully, allow their lives to be basically determined by their sinful Adamic human nature. They set their minds on the sinful human nature. They are most deeply interested in fulfilling the lusts of their sinful human nature. They constantly talk about and glory in the things pertaining to the flesh. Those who live according to the Spirit submit to the directions of the Holy Spirit. They concentrate their attention on and they specialize in whatever is precious to the Holy Spirit. It is because the disciples of Jesus Christ are not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit, that the righteous requirements of the law is able to be fulfilled in them. We'll see that. Just be patient. A literal translation of verse 5 from the Greek would read as follows. For those who are habitually dominated by the sinful nature, put their minds on the things of the sinful nature. But those who are habitually dominated by the Spirit, put their minds on the things of the Spirit. So one of the things we could ask ourselves to test whether we are authentic or not is, what is my mind habitually set on? The words, those who are habitually dominated by the sinful nature, are they that are after the flesh, as the King James Version puts the phrase. These words are in a construction in the Greek which speaks of a continuous state. It's not now something that happens occasionally. It is continuous. Paul is speaking here of persons who are unsaved. When he refers to those who are habitually dominated by the Spirit, or they that are after the Spirit, he has saved persons in mind. And we'll see it soon. Unsaved persons do not have the Spirit of God, and therefore live in the flesh and for the flesh. They have no choice. An unsaved person cannot live in the Spirit. It is impossible. Good moral deeds are not spiritual. Living a good moral upright life is not living in the Spirit. Have many people that live what they call a decent moral upright life who are unsaved. We see that as we go further in the study. The minds of these people are centered on the things that satisfy the flesh. Persons who are saved, on the other hand, have the Spirit of God within and live in an entirely new and different sphere. Their minds are centered on the things of the Spirit. This, of course, does not mean that the unsaved person never does anything good, or that the Christian never does anything bad. But it means that the inclination, the direction of their lives is different. One lives for the flesh, the other lives for the Spirit. Paul says, "They that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit." The word mind here, they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh. The word mind here is a translation of a Greek word which speaks of a deliberate setting of one's mind upon a certain thing. The unsaved person is dominated by the evil nature habitually, and habitually puts his mind on those things that the sinful nature always has springing up within itself. These are the things of sin, and the unsaved person cannot help it. On the other hand, the saved person is habitually dominated by the Holy Spirit, and as a habit puts his or her mind on those things that are promoted by the Spirit, the things that are pleasing to God. After he describes those of the flesh as those who are habitually dominated by the sinful human nature, and those of the Spirit as those who are habitually dominated by the Holy Spirit, Paul in Romans 8:6-8 spells out the final outcome of each case and provides details as to why these outcomes are inevitable and appropriate. He writes, "For to be carnally minded is what? Death. Death. But to be spiritually minded is what? Life and peace." Can't have peace if you don't have life. And we're talking now about eternal life. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God. Not just the enemy of God, you know, but is enmity. Enmity against God. Listen now, carnal mind. Enmity against God. For it is not subject to the law of God. Neither indeed can be. So then, they that are in the flesh cannot, doesn't say may not, cannot please God. Those that are in the flesh cannot please God. Cannot. It is an impossibility in the nature of the case. For a man who is in the flesh, or a woman who is in the flesh, to please God, they cannot. In general terms, Paul is saying that death is the ultimate outcome for those who walk after the flesh, whereas life and peace are the ultimate outcome for those who walk after the Spirit. He says to be carnally minded is death. The words carnally minded are literally the mind of the flesh. The mind of the flesh. Mind of the sinful Adamic nature. Flesh here refers to the evil nature. In Greek grammar, it is genitive of possession. The mind of the unsaved person is possessed by the sinful nature. An unsaved person's mind is possessed by the evil Adamic nature. Not possessed with demons, you know. It is controlled or dominated by it. They can't help it. It's not something that they can change. Notice, folks, that's why Jesus said to Nicodemus, that which is born of the flesh is flesh. There's nothing that can be done about that. Try all you can to live a good life. If you're not saved, you are flesh. And that which is born of the flesh is flesh. That's why he said, marvel not that I said unto you, you must. Person who is in the flesh is going to die and go to a devil's hell. Such a person is dead in trespasses and sins. Dead in the sense that he or she is separated from God and his life. For death is separation. Such a person is on his or her way to a final and everlasting state of death in eternity. Those that are in the flesh. That's why we who are saved have an urgent responsibility to tell it wherever we go. That's why we can't stay behind the four walls. The word spiritually minded, he says, to be spiritually minded is life and peace. That the word spiritually minded are literally the mind possessed by the Spirit. A mind controlled or dominated by the Holy Spirit. That person possesses life. The life of God. And peace. The Greek word for peace in its verb form means to bind together that which has been separated. That's how we have peace with God. We were separated from God. Once we had no peace. After having been separated from God by sin, the sinner who received New Testament salvation is now bound together with God and with the life of God. He or she is no longer separated from God or from the life of God. Such a person, therefore, experiences a supernatural, tranquilizing peace. Is there anybody here that you have gone through a terrible experience, but in the midst of it, you have just had the peace of God? Put your hands up if you know what I'm talking about. You have gone through things that would normally have made you mad, but somehow in the midst of it, God has held your mind together and you have felt peace. That's what we're talking about, folks. When Paul greets the churches and he says grace and peace, he's really saying sanctifying grace and tranquilizing peace. Paul writes and he says, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, make your requests known to God, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding. No, you can't explain why you have that peace. It passes the intellect. The human mind can't understand. I should not be feeling this way. I should be tearing my hair out. But I have a peace on the inside. That doesn't come from you, folks. That has nothing to do with you. It has everything to do with the fact that you have union with Jesus Christ. And he is giving you peace. He said, my peace I give unto you. My peace. My peace. My peace. David said, what time I am afraid, I will trust in thee. Psalm, you know why the Psalms are so frequently read and people find comfort in them? Because they are so real. You have to be careful when you read the Psalms, you know. You notice sometimes you, even in church or when you feel good, you react sometimes emotionally. There are sometimes when the psalmist said, I will not fear what man will do to me. And another time he says, what time I am afraid, I will trust in thee. In verse 7, Paul explains why the outcome for those whose minds are set on the flesh is death. He says it is because the mind that is controlled or dominated by the flesh or the sinful human nature is enmity against God. It is hostile to God. Hostile to God. It does not submit to the law of God. Nor can it do so. See, we are expecting unsaved people to behave like Christians. We are upset when they curse bad words. But before you were saved, you used to curse them. Hello? I used to curse bad words just for greeting. I see somebody that I haven't seen for a long time and I just curse a bad word. I see a long time in a seal. Don't get carnal now and think about those words. You see, folks, this is one of the hindrances we have why we are not able to incarnate. When Jesus incarnated and came to earth as a human being, he expected to encounter human beings. So he was not surprised by human reactions because he knew that he was coming to human beings. That's why the prostitute didn't turn him off. That's why he could eat with tax collectors and publicans, because before he came, he knew that he would be going among sinful people. So sin never frightened him. But we are the church, and we forget where we are coming from. So we behave as if, how could you talk like that? Well, me talk like that because I'm in the flesh and I cannot please God. Sometimes I try to behave. I remember this pastor telling me that he was on a plane, and the plane, you know, took a long time to move off, and the plane was full of Jamaicans, and they were getting upset because the flight crew were not saying anything to them as to what caused the delay. And he said the person sitting beside him began to curse. So he said, he turned to the person and said, you know, I prefer if you don't curse. And the person said, sorry, boss, but then for tell big man where I go on. And so he said, I'm going to try and find out. So he said he went up there and spoke to them and came back. And when he came back, he said, the gentleman said, but them say elder. Very nature, the carnal mind or the mind of the flesh is hostile to God by its very nature. You can't tame it. You can't teach it. That is what is in its nature. It will not submit to his law. And because of this, Paul says that those who are in the flesh cannot please God. Says the carnal mind is not subject to the law of God. Not subject to the law of God. The word subject is the translation of a Greek word meaning to arrange in order under. So the carnal mind will not arrange itself in order under. What won't it arrange itself in order under? Under God. The law of God. It was used as a military term. Referring, for example, to soldiers who were under a commanding general. The carnal mind is not marshaled under the command of God. It is marshaled under the command of Satan. Consequently, those who are within the sphere of the sinful nature are not able to please God. These are, of course, the unsaved. We're going to prove it in a little while. Some of these scriptures, we read them and mistake them and do such violence to them and terrorize people with them. Again, we say that the flesh does not submit itself to God, for it cannot do so. The flesh is the seat of indwelling sin, your sinful Adamic nature. That's where sin lives, that is where sin has its throne. It is in permanent revolt. And those who are in it cannot please God. Listen now. As far as God is concerned, from God's perspective, there are only two kinds of people in the world. Those who have been born once, and those who have been born twice. My second birth canceled out my second death. I can only die once. Second death do have no power over me because of my second birth. If you have not been born again, you're going to die more than one time. Romans 8 verse 5 indicates that the only difference God recognizes between the two classes of people is that one class does not have divine life while the other class does. There are those who are after the flesh, and there are those who are after the spirit. All human beings were born lost. Born in the state of enmity against God, as the first clause of John 3:6 indicates, that which is born of the flesh is flesh. You can't do nothing about that. By your first birth, you came here as a sinner in enmity against God. Even if you were born in an apostolic home, but God intervened and made it possible for persons to be born again through the redemptive work of Jesus Christ. We who are born again can reply to the first clause of John 3:6 with the second clause, but that which is born of the Spirit is Spirit. Yes, we agree that that which is born of the flesh is flesh, but that which is born of the Spirit is Spirit. Ask the person beside you, have you been truly born again? It's a very serious question, you know, folks. Paul says emphatically in 2 Corinthians 5:17, so then, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Folks, that listen now. Listen to me. That is God's perspective, you know. If you are in Christ, you are a new creation. God does not see you as an old creation that has been refurbished like an old house. What God sees is that the old house was torn down completely. The foundation was dug up, and a new building has been erected. A new creation. That's God's perspective. What is old has passed away. Look, what is new has come. That's the New English Translation. That new creation sets the infinite difference between those who are after the flesh and those who are after the spirit. Every individual in the world is described by one of these two phrases: after the flesh or after the spirit. Every human being in the world. There's no middle ground. This is not to say that there are no degrees within these classes, but we maintain that Scripture divides all men into one of these two classes. You have in Jamaican parlance, in each class, or in the first class, you have bad, wasara. We are the only one that can go worse than worse, you know. We have wasara. That is worse than was. No other language in the world have that, only we. Every language have bad, worse, and what else? Worst. But we have bad, wasara. That's when you're really gone bad, you know. Listen now, there are unsaved persons who are religious, and there are saved persons who are religious. There are unsaved persons who are morally upright. And there are saved persons who are morally upright. There are unsaved persons who live in criminality. And there are saved persons who live in such a manner that they have to be called carnal Christians. Yet, here's the thing, folks. The difference between these two classes in God's sight is absolute. The highest classification within the ranks of the unsaved does not reach the lowest classification within the ranks of the saved. The best unsaved man is not close in rank to the worst saved Christian. That's something we need to understand. The best unsaved person is not a child of God. The worst saved person can still say, "Abba, Father." Because it is the Spirit of God within him that cries, "Abba, Father." See, if we understood grace, we would easily understand that. But because we think the morally upright, unsaved person, you know, God sees him almost as if he's saved. We think God is impressed by our good works. The righteousness that men see in some unsaved men is a righteousness that proceeds from the corrupt heart of the sinful Adamic nature. While the true faith that does exist, even in the most carnal of all true Christians, is a faith that is born of the Holy Spirit. And the life that is in that person is the life of God in Christ. Romans 8:6-8 indicates at least four things about those who are unregenerate or unsaved, those who live according to the flesh. First, we have the description of their life. They live after the flesh. Second, we have a picture of their nature. They mind the things of the flesh. Thirdly, we have an announcement of their state. They are in death. Lastly, we have the assessment of God about their condition. They cannot please God. Outside of salvation, it is impossible for a person to please God. Outside of the works that are motivated by the Holy Spirit, all our righteousnesses are what? Filthy rags. Filthy rags. That's true of both the saved and the unsaved person. The only works that are acceptable to God are works that are promoted by the Holy Spirit. We might talk about this later, but two people can be involved in the same ministry in a church, and one of them is involved in a carnal work, and one is involved in a spiritual work. But to those who are looking on, they are doing exactly the same thing. But what is motivating them is completely opposite. can have a person, two persons, faithful in tithing, but one is carnal while one is spiritual. Can have two persons that are preaching the word. One is doing a carnal work while one is doing a spiritual work. The thing about it is that people are getting saved under both ministries. Paul said in the book of Philippians chapter 1, there are people who are preaching Christ out of strife and contention. They want to hurt me, he said. But he said, I am rejoicing because Jesus is being preached. People are getting saved. But woe unto them that preach Christ out of contention. Because the fire going to burn it up. So we looking on. That's why we have to be careful how we judge. Because we looking on, see the work, you know. But we don't know what motivated it. It's not a work of the Holy Ghost many times. We want honor. We want fame. We want position. We want a good name. And that's why we do it. And you can always know the motive. You can always know the motive. Let me ever do something quietly for Sister Simone. Nobody knows, you know. I just did it quietly. But somehow she believes it was Brother Jeffrey that did it. So she go and thank Brother Jeffrey. See how I feel inside. That will tell you what your motive is. If you really did it as a work of the Holy Ghost, you don't care if Brother Jeffrey gets the praise. Oh, you didn't like that, right? But it's true. Sometimes an ugly spirit comes into us when somebody else gets the glory. Is it true? They say something, no man. You think you can fool me? Me and you in the same boat. See, we pay attention to the externals, but God is paying attention to the internals. By him, actions are what? Weighed. God don't just look at the action and praise it. God put it in the scale. Before God praised it, God put it in the scale. I said, what was the motive behind this? We just jump up same time. Because it looked good to us. In contrast to those who are in the flesh and of whom these four things are true. Those who are born again and have received New Testament salvation are in the Spirit and are therefore able to please God. Those that are in the flesh, the Bible said, they cannot please God. Not that they may not. They cannot. It is not possible for a man in the flesh to please God. And we think that that is us. But hear what Paul says in verse 9. But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. If you have the Holy Ghost, I don't care what you feel. I don't care what you think. I don't care how you're living now. You are not in the flesh. That's what the Bible says. You are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Ask the person beside you, are you sure you have the Holy Ghost? Because if you don't have the Holy Ghost, you are in the flesh. So wife is very careful that we rightly divide the word. Because some of us know we say, well, boy, I'm in the flesh, so I can't please God. If you have the Holy Ghost, you are not in the flesh. The Bible says you are in the spirit. Now, if any man have not the spirit of Christ, he's what? None of his. None of his. No matter how good you say you're living, and no matter how good your life appears to people, if you don't have the spirit of Christ, you are none of his. No matter how good you're living, no matter how well you're doing, if you don't have the spirit of Christ, you are in the flesh. But if you have the Holy Spirit, according to verse 9, you are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. Paul's use of the word ye, you notice he says, but ye. He's turning away now and say, the verses and the people that I spoke about a while ago, you are not like them if you really have the Holy Ghost. The word ye at the beginning of the verse is emphatic in the Greek. Paul had just spoken of those who were in the sphere of the flesh, that is within the grip of the sinful Adamic nature, namely the unsaved. Then he says, but as for you, in contradistinction to the unsaved, you are not in the sphere of the evil nature, if so be that God's spirit dwells in you. The words if so be, listen, the words if so be, three words in English, they are the translation of one Greek word, which is used of something that is assumed to be the case. But whether the assumption is true or not is left in doubt. Paul says to the Roman Christians, assuming that the Spirit of God dwells in you, that is an indication that you are not in the sphere of the evil nature, but in the sphere of the Spirit. Ask the person again beside you, you're sure you have the Holy Spirit? It's a serious question, brothers and sisters. It don't make no sense to try to fake it. Because if you don't have the Holy Ghost, no matter what you do, you are in the flesh. As if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. That word dwell is the translation of a Greek word which means to live or dwell in a certain place as your home. The Holy Spirit is not only resident in the saints in the sense of positioning them, but he is actively at home in them, living in them as his home. That's why the Bible said, Paul said, what? Know you not that your body is the what? Temple of the Holy Ghost. What? What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which you have of God? Is not your Holy Ghost? Sometimes I hear us talk about my Holy Ghost. Tell me that, yes. Your Holy Ghost, I see what you mean. That means you have a different one from me and from others. That one is your Holy Ghost. You own that one. Oh Lord Jesus, help us. The Holy Ghost has a ministry to perform in us. This ministry is to give us victory over sin and produce his own fruit. This, together with the fact that God has broken the power of the evil nature, puts the saints out of the sphere of the sinful nature and within the sphere of the Holy Spirit. The saved person is therefore not in the grip of the evil nature, but under the control of the Holy Spirit as he or she yields to him. Paul says, you are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. He's talking about position. He's talking about, that is how God sees you. That is your legal standing. You are not in prison no more. You might live that way, but that is not where you actually are. If you want to live below your privilege, don't blame God for that. As far as God is concerned, you are not in the flesh, but in the spirit, assuming that you have the Holy Ghost. And brethren, see, what we do now, see, when we are checking for the Holy Ghost, what we want to make sure is that we speak in tongues. So we reach for that quick and try our best to speak in tongues. Just to check if we still have it. And if ever a day come when we check in and we don't speak in tongues, we say, Lord, Holy Ghost, leave me. And you have to go up on 7 days fasting. But the most effective way to check, you know, is to watch if the fruit of the Spirit is being born in your life. Paul lovingly assures the saints to whom he is writing that as far as the basic direction of their life is concerned, they are not under the control of the flesh but of the spirit. They do not belong to the category of those who are not able at all to please God. Every genuinely saved person has within them the ability to live a life that is pleasing to God because they are in Christ and therefore in the Spirit. See, we think being in the Spirit means. That's what we think. And we even said that him get into Spirit or she get into Spirit. Have you ever heard that term before? No. Being in the Spirit is not what you do, it is what God has done for you. By filling you with the Holy Ghost, God has translated you from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his dear Son. He's the one that translated you. You had nothing to do with it. Grace alone. But Paul says, assuming that a certain individual does not have the Spirit of Christ, this one is none of his. This, of course, is an unsaved person. Paul, in this verse, makes the possession of the Holy Spirit the essential condition, the absolutely necessary ingredient of Christian existence. Holy Spirit. If I were to ask you, and I've asked you before, but if I were to ask you, how does one become a member of the body of Christ? What would you say to me? Hey, folks, You don't know? Then why you don't answer me? What is it that places somebody in the body of Christ? Huh? What said the scripture? 1 Corinthians 12, verse 13. Could you put that up on the screen if possible for me? Huh? Screen is down. What does your Bible say? 1 Corinthians 12, 13. Find it in your Bible. You do have your Bible with you? Just the paper you have? You're depending on the paper and the screamer. Not on the scream, because the scream is down. What does the verse say? Thank you. Thank you. By one Spirit are we all baptized into one body. It is the Spirit that baptizes us into the body. That's why Paul says, if you don't have the Holy Ghost, you are none of his. Because the Holy Ghost that put you into the body, over which Christ is the head. Folks, you don't have to go further than scripture, you know. By one Spirit are we all baptized into one body. That is plain as day. You don't have to fight with the scripture. That's what the Bible said. The possession of the Holy Spirit is absolutely necessary for Christian existence. If any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. Paul emphasizes this in Galatians chapter 4 and verse 6. He says, but when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth, well, I'm reading actually from verse 4. Make note of that for me. Galatians 4, 4 to 6. But when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. And because you are sons, God hath sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. See, the whole world, when you ask them, they say, then talk about God. And they talk about the Father. But when you have the Holy Ghost, something in you cries out, Abba. It's more than just the Father or God. It is saying, Daddy, I'm one of your sons. Listen now. In Romans 8 verse 9, Paul is giving the Christians in Rome the assurance that they are not included among those who are in the flesh. He says, you are not in the flesh. He addresses them in the verses before when he's talking about the classes of people. He speaks generally. He said, those that are in the flesh do that. Those that are in the spirit do that. But now he speaks to them and says, you are not in the flesh. You Christians at Rome, I don't want you to mistake this. You are not in the flesh. And listen, folks, not all of them were living right, because Paul had to correct bad behavior in the church in Rome. But he says, you are not in the flesh. You are in the spirit if the Holy Ghost is in you. So we think that if a Christian is not living right, they are not in the spirit, they are in the flesh. I'm sorry. That's not what the Bible says. Once the person has the Holy Spirit, as far as their position is concerned, God sees them as being in the spirit, not in the flesh, because he has moved them. And if God has moved them, you can't unmove them. What God has done can't be altered by you or me, even though we might want to try. Because we are always wanting to intervene in God's work, you know. We always have our opinion, which is not necessarily backed up by the scripture. In Romans 7 verse 5, Paul describes those that are in the flesh. And he says, when we were in the flesh, you see, he's talking about a past thing. When we were in the flesh, the motions of sin, which were by the law, did work in our members to bring forth fruit unto death. Paul said we were in the flesh one time, of course. On the contrary, he says they are in the spirit. And in this respect, they are like those described in Romans 7, 6. But now, we are delivered from the law, that being dead wherein we were held, that we should serve in newness of spirit, and not in the oldness of the letter. This is true, however, only if they are truly saved and receive the Spirit of God. In Romans 8, 9, Paul sets before us both a negative, listen now, we soon finish, a negative and a positive description of the character and the position of the child of God. Both negative and positive. Negatively, he says that we are not in the flesh. So we know it's negative because we see the word not. He says you are not in the flesh. Even though we are forced to confess that the flesh is in us. Hello? We are not in the flesh. Although the flesh is in us, the Adamic nature is still in us. How you know that it is still in you? How you know that it is still in you? Because it brings you down sometime, even today. Positively now, he says that we are in the spirit. The proof of our position in Christ is that the Holy Spirit dwells in us. The statement that we are not in the flesh, this is so important now, folks. When Paul says we are not in the flesh, that is a divine statement. That didn't come from Paul. It came through Paul from the Holy Ghost. It would never be possible for us to know that we are not in the flesh except that God had revealed it to us in his word. Of our own knowledge, we could know nothing but the fact that sin is in us. If we looked at our daily lives only, and the thoughts that we think, we would be forced to believe that we are still in the flesh. If God didn't say you are not in the flesh but in the spirit, we would have said we're still in the flesh because we mess up so often. But Paul is taking us beyond human reasoning, and that's where the church needs to go. We are restricting God to our little puny minds and thinking that God thinks like us. And because we don't think we deserve it, God said, yes, it's true. You're not saved really. You're still in this flesh. All right. You're still in the flesh. Have it your way. No. It's a defined statement. God is taking it out of our hands because some of us could never think that we are in the spirit. says, by way of the Holy Ghost, you are not in the flesh. What God has done, none of us can undo it in the life of any of his children. It is God who says that we are not in the flesh. Whose report will we believe? Sin that you committed today and yesterday rises up in you and says, you are still in the flesh. God says you are in the spirit, you're not in the flesh. Whose report will you believe? I have translated you from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of my dear son. How dare you question what I have done? Are you more righteous than me? If I were depending on your good works to determine your status, none of you would be in this building. Not one single soul would be in this building. Sometimes when I go abroad, I say to the folks in the building, I say, would you like for us to have an absolutely holy church right now? And they say, yes, Pastor Bartlett. I said, all right, we can do it in 10 minutes. In 10 minutes, let all of us leave the building. And it's a holy church we have. But if the first person come in, you come in with your unworthiness. Fine statement. We must look with confidence at God's word and his declaration. Too many of us have our faith grounded in what we feel and what we think and what we have been told by others and not in the revelation of God. We despise revelation. Some of us deliberately despise revelation. Because it doesn't suit our theology. But folks, I'm kind of one of those persons that I am happy, and that's why we give you notes. And that's why you can go on YouTube. Is it YouTube? Or live stream? Live stream, I mean to say. Live stream. You can go on live stream and you can listen to it for yourself and you can check it for yourself. Look, if there's another book that tells you that you are in the flesh and not in the spirit, you have the Holy Ghost but you are in the flesh, you read and see if there's anything that said that. Might not suit your revelation, but check it out. I really want us to do that. Because the more we probe these things, the more the truth of God will be cemented in us. That's the right way. Pastors must encourage the people that they pastor to dig into the word of God for themselves. We are in the spirit, brethren. This is the simple declaration of God. He knows what he had in mind when he set out to accomplish our redemption. And he knows that he has accomplished that which he purposed to do. He knows it. What's the proof? How do we know that God knows that he has accomplished what he set out to do? It's in the word, Romans 8, 28 to 30. Can you imagine the joy we're going to have when we come to it? But we don't come to it yet. These verses refers to our salvation. And they refer to it from start to finish in the past tense. Not in the present tense or in the future tense. Listen to what God says. And we know. We do what? We think it is so, or we know. We know that how many things work together for good. Good things, right? All things. Them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. Listen now. For whom he did foreknow, past tense, he also did predestinate, past tense, to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called, past tense. And whom he called, them he also justified, past tense. And whom he justified, them he also glorified, past tense. As far as God is concerned, you are already glorified. I didn't say it. The word said it. Past tense in English and in Greek. Past tense. Glorification, properly speaking, has not yet occurred actually to us. As glorification speaks about the redemption of our bodies at the rapture, when God puts us in a position where it is impossible for us to sin again. When we receive our new body, that is what glorification is. But here Paul says we have already been glorified. Why does Paul speak like that? Because Paul said this is a God business. Folks, I need for you to think about it unemotionally. It's very plain. Whom he did foreknow, we know that is in the past. He also did predestinate, that is in the past. Whom he did predestinate, them he also called. You could probably testify as to when the Lord called you. That was sometime in the past. Those whom he called, them he also justified. He didn't say he's justifying them. He said they are justified. Those whom he justified, he didn't say he's glorifying them. He says they are glorified. Why? Because God said, I know what I set out to do. Who can tell me no? Anybody can stop me from doing what I purpose to do? You are already glorified because it's me doing the work. If I were to leave it up to you, none of you would be saved. In Romans 8:9, the Holy Spirit tells us through Paul that we are not in the flesh. He tells us we are in the spirit. We are joined to Christ as our federal head. We are placed in the spirit as a revelation of our position in God. In the sight of the eternal God, we are complete. We have been incorporated into the body of Christ. Listen, there's a little preposition in the verse, in. In. Says we are not in the flesh, but in the spirit, if so be that the spirit of Christ dwell in you. The little word in preposition is used to indicate two completely different things. Paul first states that we are in the spirit, but he also states that the spirit is in us. It is the coming of the life of God through the Holy Spirit that places us in the Spirit and in Christ. The Holy Spirit then is seen as the source of our position and place in God. Paul said, He had raised you up to sit in heavenly places in Christ. Should be noted at once that these glorious facts are true of every genuine child of God. It applies equally to new converts, to those who have some growth in Christ, and to those who have grown the most in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. The more we grow and mature in Christ, is the more we bow in humility before these great truths. If you believe that you are in the church and you're growing, and when you get these beautiful revelations, it don't make you more humble and thankful to God, you have not grown as much as you think. If it put pride in you, you are far away. More you understand about the grace of God, the more it drives you just to tears and to worship God. Because you know this it could never be me. The more you understand about the grace of God, is the more you love God. And the more you want to please Him. The most mature saints know best that all they have and all they are is the result of the work of the Spirit of God within them. More mature you get is the more you understand that revelation. I was saying it to a Sunday school class, I think 2 weeks ago. I was teaching a Sunday school class. And I said to them, isn't it strange? And I've said it before in Bible study. Isn't it strange that as Paul is growing in God and growing in the knowledge and the grace of God, is the less he's seeing himself, while we are seeing ourselves greater. We think that as we grow, we are greater. And Paul is seeing himself less. Something wrong with us if we think we are good. Man came to Jesus and said, good master, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said, why callest thou me good? There's only one good. That is God. Only one good. And that is God. So if you're calling me good, I hope you understand that you're calling me God. But we are not God. So we are not good. Because there's only one good. And that is God. Paul said, first self-assessment. We have been through it before. He said, I am the least of the apostles. So I'm kind of start off humble. Because he didn't say, I am the greatest of the apostles. He said, I'm the least. But the apostles were first rank. So he says, I am the least among the greatest. That seemed to be pretty humbly, although after he said that, right after that he said, but I labored more abundantly than all of them. But he said after that, yet not I, the grace of God labored in me. So Paul is saying, no worry, think it's me. I was doing the work, but it was the Holy Ghost the grace of God that was doing the work in me. Second assessment, Romans 7, chronological, we're talking about, you know. We're looking at the assessments as they came in time. First one was, I am the least of the apostles. Second one, now he says, I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. I'm realizing that now, nothing good in the flesh. No matter what school you go, no matter what education you have, nothing good. That can't help you or save you. Nothing good. You might have been to grammar school. No matter. Might have your PhD. Might be a successful professional. Doctor, lawyer, Indian chief. Still can't help you where your salvation is concerned. That don't impress God. That not going to cause God to look at you and say, oh boy, I would like to have a doctor in the church. It would be good to have an attorney at law in the church. Mm-mm, that are not God. So we think God wants to call people that will give glory to him. So what we call, not many mighty, not many noble, not many wise. God had chosen, not the pastor, not the church. God had chosen weak things, foolish things, things that are not, things that are despised. God had chosen why? So that no flesh will glory in his presence. When you come in here, forget about where you work. Whether you come in here or not, when you're dealing with God, forget about your profession. Forget about your learning. Forget about your status. Forget about where you live. It no matter to God. I'm sorry. It matter to we. Don't impress God one bit. Third one. Ephesians. I, who am less than the least of all the saints. First time he said, I am the least of the apostles, you know. Now him say, him do him say, he's the least of the saints. Him say, I am less than the least of all the saints. Paul is saying, the least of the saints is better than me. But him growing, you know. But when we grow, we see ourselves better than the saints. Something wrong with your growth. I guess it's that the economists call negative growth. Last time now, final time he make assessment. What did he say? First Timothy. This is a faithful saying. Worthy of all acceptation. That Christ Jesus came into the world to save who? Sinners. Of whom I was chief. No. Of whom I am still. I see myself as the chief of sinners. In fact, if you read that, the following verses, what Paul says is, you know the only reason why Jesus saved me? The only reason why Jesus saved me is to use me as an example. That's why I am saved. That anybody who believes they cannot be saved, God said, look at Paul. If I can save Paul, I can save you. Paul said, that's why I'm saved. Chief of sinners. What happened, Paul? You're backsliding? No. I'm growing. Coming closer to the light. And as I come closer to the light, is the more filthy the garment look. The light shining. Things I never see before, I see now. Never know that this attitude was so rotten. Now I see it. I used to say, it's something bad. He's an August man. A summer stay. Now I'm seeing. I saw you stay, but you not stay good. The light shining. You not look so good, Paul. You're backsliding. No, I'm growing. Funny how we growing. Now we're looking better to ourselves. Eh? When you understand the grace of God, you never look good to yourself. You only look good in God. That's why Paul said, God forbid that I should glory, save in the cross. That is all my glory. In the cross. But equally, the newest babe in Christ, you don't have to draw back because you are a baby. The very instant an individual passes out of death and into life, he or she is no longer legally in the flesh, but in the spirit. The spirit is in him or her from that same moment, and all the truths of grace are theirs. None of these things is gained by anything we have done. All of this perfection of position is a result of the grace of God through the Lord Jesus Christ. What comfort this should give to those of us who are just learning to look away from self and to fix our attention on Jesus Christ. What calm this should give to those of us who are inclined to be agitated because we are only just learning to rest completely in Christ and to look away from confidence in the flesh. What a joy this should be for us to know that even though we are struggling, legally we are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. We still are able to please God. The man in the flesh can never please God. And even though a vessel I may be, broken and small, still his blessing fall on me, sweeter than all. Let me show you something, folks, as we close. Ushers, please come. Ephesians. Chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 8. Look at this critically. For by grace are ye saved through faith. The faith that you have was not of yourselves. Paul said you are saved by grace through faith, but even the faith is not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. It is the gift of God. The faith that you got to believe God didn't come from you. It is the gift of God. It's not of yourselves. You can't even boast about faith. Faith only have one purpose in our brethren. Faith only have one use. And that is what makes it so important. God has given us everything freely. Is not faith give us? Is God give us? What faith does is to convince us it is true. It really belongs to you. Take what God has given you freely because it is yours. Faith says, when we have done that is which is wrong as sin, faith says, the word says, come boldly to the throne of grace. Because gloom and sadness say, you have sinned, no use to pray. But faith said, the word says, come boldly still, that you may obtain mercy and find grace to help. Don't creep and come boldly. Push open the door. stand and worship Jesus, who is our Lord and our God, the one that has done all these things for us. That not of yourselves. That not of yourselves. God is cutting the ground away from the feet of all of us who want to boast. Not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. By grace are you saved through faith. But even that is not of yourselves. It is the gift of God.
Amen. Let's lift our hands together, everybody, one more time. It's all about you, Jesus. It's all about you. It is of the Lord's mercies why we are not consumed. It's all about you, Jesus. It's all about you.